Good afternoon, everyone in Easton and vicinity. Great to be back in this lovely town. I'll get some underwriters for you for our topic time episode, and then we'll start the show. We have Shovel Shop Spirits right here in Easton. We got John's Greenhouses and Flower Shop in Brockton. We got CNC Reading Farm in West Bridgewater that'll have the best Christmas trees for the season. We got Furnace Brook Motors in Easton. We got Bridgewater Discount Liquors in Bridgewater. And we got the Smoke and Ashes Tobacco Company at convenient locations in Abington, Hanson, Hanover, Pembroke, Weymouth, and Whitman. And on that note, we will now start topic time, and thank you all very much. And here we go. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Topic Time with Harrison Young. A little reiteration, but why not? And it's kind of a nice fall day out there. It's a little crisp. It's balmy. It's sunny. And on goes the tradition with great musicians that I've had on my show going back to the summer. It just keeps on getting better and better. I had one yesterday in my Cabo location, and I got one today in Easton. This is Jeffrey Gaynor. He's a very well-known musician, and he's also going to perform some live stuff for us today. Maybe something original, maybe a cover, whatever he wants. He brought a playlist, and he's going to, you know, consult it when we take a break to hear him perform and sing or whatever he does. But first, we're also going to talk to him and learn all about him. So, Jeffrey Gaynor, thanks for coming on as my guest on Topic Time today.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Okay, well, you're a musician, and you know, like I do with all my guests, I like to find out about the history, how they got to be where they're at. Mm-hmm. You look like the kind of guy that could be a rocker or an R&B guy or a rapper. Which is it? You tell me. Or even a classical player.
Starting from when I was a young kid.
How young?
When I was I started playing piano when I was about 7.
Okay.
And you know, my teacher that I had for when I was really young, all the way till the end of high school. We did classical stuff, but he also had me play rock and roll. He had me play jazz. He had me play all kinds of stuff.
Oh, yeah, I forgot. You could have been a jazz man,
absolutely,
too.
Absolutely, yeah. And he was a jazz guy, because he had...
Anyone I may have heard of?
His name was Eddie Honorado. He was out of the New York City area.
I know the name.
Because that's where I grew up.
Okay.
I grew up in North Jersey, right by New York City.
Yeah, I know. My family was
originally all from...
New Jersey?
From New York.
As I hear you talk, I notice you got a slight New Jersey dialect, and I also noticed on your... on your area code, when you phoned me earlier, that you had a New Jersey area code.
Yeah, I never bothered changing it. I've lived in Massachusetts most of the last 13 years, but I never bothered changing the phone number because it was just easier.
So you took piano lessons when you started starting at 7, and you with Eddie Honorado. And that name, he sounds very professional.
Yeah.
Is he still playing today?
No, he passed on.
He passed,
rest his soul, yeah.
But, okay, I had to ask. But
sure.
Obviously an inspiration to you and got you where you are today.
Oh, yeah, no, he was amazing because he taught me so much. I mean, we would cover lots of different styles of music, and he taught me to conduct, and we worked on music history, and he had some amazing stories. I mean, this is a guy.
Let me ask you something. Did he make you do compositions on composers?
Well,
he never had
me write essays. There would be sometimes like test questions after you'd read some stuff, but we would mostly just talk about our favorite composers and things that we liked. And he was an amazing inspiration. He really was. And he encouraged me to write my own stuff.
And he taught you, and I guess you, and when you do music, you got to do it from the soul, basically.
Yeah, absolutely.
To be able to really write well and create stuff that people are going to really want to hear. And
definitely.
The reason I asked you about the different styles is because I want to know what you consider your genre now. Are they multiple genres?
Honestly, okay. Because I've always been into so many different kinds of music.
Yep.
Right from the time I was very, very little, music was definitely in my blood. So, I mean... whether it was my favorite theme songs from television shows or film scores or stuff that was on the radio at the time when I was growing up.
Are you a Hill Street Blues guy?
All this stuff. Hill Street Blues, yeah.
I mean, it's instrumental.
That was one of those
things. Oh, wait a minute. That's Rockford Files. I'm sorry.
Well, they're both instrumentals.
But
Hill Street Blues and a couple of those other things. I remember in grammar school, that was one of those things that anybody, any fledgling piano player, you would want to try to play that lick from the Hill Street Blues.
Now, what about vocal stuff? Do you sing too?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did he also teach you to sing as well?
He didn't teach me vocal coaching. I got that later on. Oh. I became good friends. The choir director at my old high school. We were friendly when I was in school, but it was when I was in college afterwards, and I still had a lot of friends in high school that I started doing work with him, the choir director. He would have me as an accompanist. I would chaperone trips, and then he would grab me. He's like, I need an accompanist, and I need an extra tenor. So he'd bring me along on trips to Canada or trips to Virginia when they would have these music competitions where schools would come from all over the country.
Did you go to one of those performing schools for the arts, like in Fame?
No, I did not. I went to a public school in North Jersey, but we had an amazing music and arts program.
I guess you did. That's amazing. That's great. You got to travel like that.
Before the days, they started chopping the budgets, unfortunately. But that's starting to shift back in the other direction, which is great.
If you don't mind my asking, what was the timeline for this? I mean, you don't look too old. You look about 30-ish, 36.
You flatter me. I'm definitely over 30.
Are you? Well, okay. You couldn't be as old as me, but... So what decade are we talking?
I'm going to be 49 in 2 weeks.
Oh, really? No, yeah. I would never have believed it.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
Boy, so you were born in 1969.
69, yeah.
Tell you, what's your date of birth? I'll tell you what day of the week you were born.
The 20th of November, yeah.
November 20th, 19. Yeah, it was 2 days after my grandmother died. It was a Thursday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And I remember they telling me it was Thursday.
Yep, that's right. I told you, I remember everything.
When we were kids, you did that thing in grammar school. It's like, what day of the week were you born on? And everybody sort of listed out.
Well, I have Asperger's, and it enables me to remember stuff.
Yeah, well, I have a
I had that milestone event that week.
Sure. That's going to be something that'll stay with
right,
you.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Right, so, okay. Well, I'll never forget that. Okay, so you definitely don't look your age. That's great. So,
well, thanks.
Runs
in the family.
But the reason I'm asking, too, is because I wanted to know what the timeline was, given the realization that it's given you a lot. You had a lot of time to perform stuff. So where have you performed, capacity?
Well, starting in high school, I mean, actually starting not even in high school, everybody was putting together rock bands. And so I started playing originally with guys that I had known literally since I was a toddler.
Okay.
And, you know, you'd play school concerts and things like that. And then that was mainly playing stuff at, like, high school and some local colleges. And then my first bar gig was... right after I turned 18, we had played a show at the high school. I was
still
a year.
In Jersey.
Still in Jersey.
North Jersey.
So I
West Paterson area.
No, way northeast Jersey, Bergen County.
Oh, okay.
Dumont.
Northeast. Okay.
Dumont.
I thought that's.
Yeah.
I've been down there, and I thought that West Paterson, Todd, whatever, and those are like the most eastern or the northern parts of the state.
No, you got to go. If you go all the way up to Bergen County, you got, you know, Dumont and Creskill and all there. You know, way up. I mean, I was like barely 20 minutes from the George Washington Bridge.
Oh, I see.
With no traffic.
Okay, so you were so you were still in that area when you were performing, and you first got your first bar gig.
Absolutely.
And how old
were
you when you got your first bar gig?
I had just turned 18.
Okay, just legal.
So we were. I was a freshman year in college. We had band. I went to CCNY in Manhattan first.
Okay.
I went there like a year and a half, and then I finished at Montclair State
in New Jersey.
Yep. Yeah.
Wow.
And so one of the guys in the band was still in high school. He was a senior. So we played a show with that lineup. I remember it was at Christmas time, and we played the talent show at the high school. And then that Saturday night, we played, I think the first time any of us, well, first time I played, a paid bar gig.
Wow, that is so
cool.
And
they kept a close eye on us, because only one of us was 21 and the rest were all underage.
Yeah,
so
they kept
an eye on everybody to make sure they weren't drinking.
You're right, so 18, it was the 21 was the legal limit
So we opened up for some friends of ours.
Wow.
Who had a band, and they were the headliner. We did one set, and then they played the rest of the night.
That is so
awesome.
All
of us were doing all original material.
Wow. And I take it you majored in music at those colleges you went to, right?
Well, I studied music, and I was studying film production when I was at CCNY, and then I studied creative writing when I was at Montclair.
Okay, well, that's
important. So my degree ended up being in English, but I was doing music the whole time as well as everything else.
Okay, wow. So let's talk about some of the other things, creative writing and filmmaking. Now, have you done any film acting or creative writing? I've done a little bit.
Actually, the films... Two of the films that I've scored some indie films.
Okay.
I started doing it when I was still living in New Jersey.
You mean putting music on?
Doing all
on
the music,
right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so the first film that I scored when I was still living in New Jersey before I moved up here, this is back in 2004, I think it was.
Okay.
It was a film called The Crusaders. It was sort of a take on the Avengers,
oh, okay.
male-female
yeah.
spy
sure.
duo. So... the gentleman who wrote and directed the film actually approached a guy whose band I had played in.
Okay.
And he said, would you guys like to play the soundtrack? And the band leader, Bill, was Bill Turner and Blue Smoke, actually a great band.
Wow, yeah.
And Bill Turner had actually played with Bill Haley in the Comets in the 70s.
Oh, man, that is, so you were pretty
big company. When he was in his youth and Haley was like on the road for the last time, Bill played guitar for him. So the director approached him, you want to score this film? And Bill was like, well, I don't write, but my old keyboard player does. So Bill grabbed me, I wrote all the music, and then with that band, we recorded the score for that film. And he had it, he wanted sort of a 60s surf rock spy movie, kind of a throwback feel to it.
Oh my goodness.
So that's kind of stuff we did for
that. So you wrote the score
for
that. Yeah. It must have been, the music must have been really enticing, like da 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 da.
Yeah, it had kind of a surf rock, James Bond surf rock kind of a thing.
That's what I figured.
It was a lot of fun to do. And that's something that I've always wanted to do. From the time I was a kid, I basically wanted to be, you know, Paul Stanley and Steven Spielberg and John Williams. And I wanted to, you know, I wanted to do music. I wanted to do movies. I kind of did the whole thing.
Spielberg,
from the time I was very, very young.
It's funny you should say Spielberg. He actually directed a film I was in, my very first one. And I was an extra in Amistad in 1997.
Oh, you were? Okay.
Yes.
Oh, that's great.
He fired me.
Really?
Yeah, I bought, it was his fault, but we were doing a dated scene and I botched the line because we were in 1839 and he said, we had a scene where John Quincy Adams was falling asleep in the chambers, a.k.a. Anthony Hopkins, and he said, inquiries to his well-being. And I go, is he okay? And he said, they didn't say it like that in 1839. And he literally, he made me an example of me right there in the room in front of about 100 strangers that I was acting with, when he could have very easily just said, make sure you don't use 20th century jargon. Because I'd never been in a film before. I was 37 and a half.
Sure.
And then I was supposed to go to Newport, Rhode Island the following Monday and do some scenes there. And I was cut. And he gave me a dirty look as I was leaving the State House. But that's okay. I made up for that, and I was in Shutter Island with Scorsese 11 years later.
Okay.
Playing a rental place in a role I was born to play. Mm-hmm. And Scorsese was great. I worked with him directly, and he loved directing me. And we had a great, you know, afternoon working in Medfield, Massachusetts, in a mental hospital, which what once was. But getting back to you, so you wrote the scores for, how many films have you written scores for?
I have to count off the top of my head. I mean, there was did the one, and it won a couple of festival awards.
Great.
And then I moved, at the end of 05, beginning of 06, I moved up here.
Okay, why?
To partially because I knew that my day job at the time, see, I've gone through periods where I was gigging all the time and had a day job and not sleeping a lot.
Okay.
And then playing full time and then playing with a day job, et cetera. Now, for the better part of the last 8 years or so, I've been full-time musician without a day job, but at the time I knew that my day job was going to be coming to Boston whether I liked it or not.
Okay.
And I decided I also just kind of needed to get out of Jersey because things were sort of
You have to go where the money was.
And I also need, like, creatively and musically, I felt like I was sort of running in the same circles and I needed to sort of shake things up.
Okay.
Just in general. So I said, at least I know I'll be able to pay the rent. Let me just go to Boston. And I had a couple of friends in Boston.
Okay.
So then I made connections with them and made other connections and saw a Craigslist ad not long after I moved up. I was looking for film scoring things, and I was just looking for musical opportunities in general. And I saw an ad on Craigslist placed by who's a very dear friend of mine, Jackie Schnabel, a brilliant writer-director.
Okay.
She had an ad looking for music for a film she had already shot. She had shot a short.
Wow.
So I answered the ad. I called her. We were on the phone for like 9 hours and became great friends. And her husband as well and I became good buddies. And we still are to this day. And I did a number of projects with her.
He's still doing them now?
Starting with that one. And I've done probably at least 7 or 8 different projects with her.
That is awesome.
One feature and then a bunch of different shorts.
Wow.
And
how long is the feature?
And acted in 2 of them and did voices for another one of them.
Boy, I love having such multifaceted people on my show. I mean, I come in, I ask for a musician, and I get a full scale of everything, basically, you know, of a man of all trades, which is cool,
coolest. I try.
Yeah, wow. I wish we had more time to talk about all the other stuff you've done too. Yeah. But the fact that you've acted already, what did you play in those films?
The first one was Jackie had already shot the film.
Yep.
And she needed music for it, and it was sort of a horror comedy spoof about drag queens who become killer zombies. And she wanted the music for that, and then she had shot one half of a phone conversation. She needed to shoot the other half.
Okay.
So I did the other half of that, and I was also a drag queen. I was a drag queen phone sex operator.
Okay.
Which was hilarious.
I'm sure it was.
And then I did all the music. And for that film, she wanted sort of 80s techno synth style stuff for that one. Right. So I just did that. I used, you know, just a drum machine and a bunch of synthesizers, and it was all me, because that was kind of the style that she wanted. So that was the first one. And then the next one I did with her was a feature length film.
Okay.
Full, you know, 90 minutes or whatever it was. And she also had a lead part for me as an actor in that, and had me score the entire thing as well.
You know, what did you play in that?
I played a scientist slash musician, actually.
Okay.
Because she sort of fashioned the part around me. She wanted, for the story that she already had in mind, she wanted me to play the scientist, but she also wanted the music to be a part of it as well.
Cool.
So I was able to get some buddies of mine from Jersey to come up and do a scene playing as my band when we were rehearsing in one little scene.
Wow.
And I actually met my now wife through shooting that film.
Cool.
She was one of the other actors in that movie.
Does she do full-time acting at all?
She has done tons of...
From the pictures I've seen on Facebook, it looks like she's quite well inundated for acting.
Like
and stuff.
Me, for a lot of her career, she's had a day job and performed and, yep. not gotten a lot of sleep.
I see.
So she's done tons and tons of live theater and interactive theater. She was in a production of The Miracle Worker a year ago.
Yeah, what's that girl's
brilliant.
Name? Helen Keller,
right? Yeah, she played Annie Sullivan.
Oh, okay.
In that production. But she's done tons of interactive theater, Renaissance fairs, things like that.
Cool.
All up and down the East Coast.
Maybe we can get her on the show.
And I'm sure she loved it. And,
okay.
now she's a teacher and a studio director.
Cool, okay. Yeah. A studio director, I mean, we're in one of the, like for a film studio?
Well, a studio where they have the programs for the kids. She teaches tech enrichment.
Okay.
They teach kids robotics and coding and video game design and animation and things.
Oh, cool,
A place called MPOW. They're in Lexington and Newton.
Oh, wow, okay, nice upscale towns too, so
great.
It must be pretty nice.
And they do amazing work. What the kids are doing is incredible, so.
Wow, that is so cool. All right, well, so, what are your days like? I mean, you've had quite an enriching background. Yeah. When it comes to, just one more question about creative writing. What creative writing have you done besides music? Anything?
Well,
scripts,
nothing,
poetry?
It mostly has been fiction and poetry / song lyrics.
Okay.
So as a songwriter from the time I was very young, my cousin and I started writing songs when we were like 11.
Wow.
We had our little band that we
had. Did you say fiction too? Did you write stories?
Yeah, wrote lots of fiction. Only had things published really in high school and college,
okay.
in the magazines there, but never stopped writing, just, you know, in general. And so that was a big part of what I wanted to do growing up, because I wanted to, you know, write films and write songs and everything else. So
Have you ever written a script for a film in a while?
I've written enough screenplays that, you know, never really got picked up. I didn't go actively pursuing that. Music ended up becoming my frontline thing for most of my life, pretty much. And what
so,
has taken
so,
me into
music
film
is
and everything
pretty much
else.
Is your dominant thing, and
right.
as it should be. I mean, you love it. That's what you've been doing for so
Absolutely.
Long.
Absolutely. Yeah. No. It's in my blood.
Okay.
Beyond in my blood. Yeah.
So now, fast forward to 20. You know, we're in fall 2018. What do you spend your time doing? You're all full time musician.
My main bread and butter is working as a dueling pianist. All request dueling pianos. The audience picks the songs and we play and we trade songs back and forth. And I've spent time, right now I'm at a bar called D's Keys. It's on D Street by the waterfront, by the convention center.
Quincy or Boston?
In Boston proper.
Boston, okay.
Yeah, it's on D Street.
It's probably in South Boston.
We just opened.
Is it South Boston?
Technically, they would call it the convention center neighborhood.
I think that is Southie because all the lettered streets are in Southie.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, it's probably, right, that's what it sounds like.
Yeah, so
it's
D's Keys.
Nice area.
D's Keys on D Street. And every Wednesday through Sunday, we're open. We have live music every Wednesday through Sunday.
Wow, okay.
And it's all requests from the crowd and everybody has a good time and we play their tunes and...
Do any performing in Berkeley?
A lot of friends and have performed with a lot of people who went to Berkeley.
Oh, you have? Okay.
And we have done a lot of work together playing at clubs that I played in the past and in the Somerville, Cambridge area and also in Boston.
Okay. Ever performed The Rat?
Actually, no.
You haven't?
No,
okay.
I know people who have played there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I know.
I've played
I have
lots of places.
On my show.
Cambridge, Somerville, you know, Lizard Lounge, Toad, all those places in that area.
How about the Catbird Cafe in Weymouth? Have you performed there?
Weymouth, no.
Oh, okay.
No. Played up and down from North Shore in Maine up down to the Cape, but never there.
Oh, okay. That's interesting.
Yeah.
So you're pretty inundated with stuff, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a break, and we're going to hear you perform a couple of really awesome songs that you brought in on a playlist, and then we're going to wrap the show up. So you okay with that?
Sounds like a plan.
Yeah, we're going to have some live music here in Easton, and we're going to love it.
This song is called The Ones Who Matter.
So please keep come out for Junior. Don't let me wait. Catholic girls stop much too late. I'll be sooner or later. Comes down to fate. I might as well be the one. Well, they showed you a statue, taught you to pray. They built you a temple and locked you away. Yeah, but they never told you the price that you pay. The things that you might have done. You know that only the good die young. That's what I said. Only the good die young. Only the good die young. You got a nice white dress and a party on your confirmation. Oh, you got a brand new soul and a cross of gold. But Virginia, they didn't give you quite enough information. Yeah, you didn't count on me. Well, you were counting on your rosary. Whoa, 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 come out, come out, come out. Virginia, don't let me wait. Catholic girls die much too late. Sooner or later it comes down to fate. I might as well be the one. You know that only the good die young. That's what I said. Only the good die young. Only the good die young.
Well, that was unbelievable. What a performer you are. My goodness.
Oh,
yeah, no,
good times.
I can only see great things happening for you in the future. So we're just about out of time, but tell me about what the future looks like for Jeffrey Gaynor. What are your plans? You gonna travel further, do more performing?
I'm going to start teaching piano in the new year.
Okay.
In addition to what I'm doing.
Congratulations.
The main bread and butter will be the dueling pianos for a while and teaching and doing session work, local session work, studio stuff in the area, which I've been doing the whole time with people.
Right. Okay.
Here.
Planning on going anywhere, you know, performing outside, you know, outside of New England, and going back to New Jersey, New York, or Nashville.
I do occasionally do that. When I was a freelancer doing dueling pianos, I was all over the country.
Wow.
Mainly up and down in the Northeast. But, you know, was down in North Carolina and out in Nebraska.
There you go.
Wherever the gig is where you have to go.
Right. So. And if it takes you somewhere else, you'll go there again. You'll go. You're not afraid to travel, you know, transcontinentally, correct?
Yeah. Well, I mean, like I said, if you go where the gig is. So, I mean, right now I'm not having to travel too much, which is nice.
Okay.
To be home
but you like what you're doing. You're making good money.
And you're here
with me tonight. You couldn't ask for a better deal than that.
Very grateful.
All right. Very quickly. We're just about to wrap the show up. You want to give some shouts out to people that are going to see it? Just condense them and we'll wrap it up.
Shout out to my wife and shout out to Empower Studios and shout out to D's Keys on D Street every Wednesday through Sunday. Come and see us and we will rock your world. And that's about all I can say right now.
Well, great job.
Find me on Facebook.
Yeah.
I'm on Facebook.
Jeffrey Gaynor.
Jeff Gaynor.
Well, I hope you had a good time with me tonight. All right.
Had a great time. Thank you.
All right. Well, on that note, we're going to wrap it up. See you next time. Take care. Enjoy more episodes of Topic Time.